now under the microscope. Plus, help wanted. The president needs a new chief of staff, but the top candidate says no thanks. And others said to be on the shortlist rush to send signals, they're not that interested. And maybe you've never heard of John Hickenlooper, but the Colorado governor thinks the Democrats need a Washington outsider atop the 2020 ticket.
On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being you're running, how close are you?
I'd say we're past 50-50. I think we're probably 63, 64%, 6.4.
We begin the hour, though, with the current president and brand new details on just what he's looking for as he looks for his next chief of staff. That, as many here in Washington wonder, who in the world would want the job in the first place? The leading contender was Nick Ayers. He's currently serving as the vice president's chief of staff. But a White House official tells CNN Ayers and the president could not agree on the position's terms. Trump wanted him to commit for 2 years through the reelection campaign, but Ayers declined. John Kelly, the second man to hold the job, is leaving at the end of this year. CNN's Caitlin Collins is live at the White House. Caitlin, the president and Nick Ayers, their deal fell apart, but you've learned new details on a task the president gave his the man we thought would take the job before he said, no, thank you, sir.
That's right. They were still in the negotiations over whether or not Nick Ayers was actually going to take this job. And President Trump had already given him some instructions for what he wanted it to look like if he did become chief of staff. And one big thing was he wanted him to conduct this thorough review of how the West Wing operates, because President Trump wants it to be more politically focused. John, he's becoming more concerned about what Washington is going to look like come January when those newly empowered House Democrats have the power that they will, including potentially forcing his cabinet secretaries to testify, looking at his tax returns, and just having oversight of even some of his most controversial policy decisions. And President Trump wanted his new chief of staff to make sure the West Wing is ready for that and that they're politically focused moving forward. That was one of his biggest complaints about John Kelly, is that he did not feel that the retired Marine general was politically shrewd enough to handle that. And he didn't think he was up to the task to handle what Washington is going to look like over the next 2 years. Now, Nick Ayers is not taking this job. They could not come to an agreement over the timing, since he wanted to do it on an interim basis, and President Trump wanted that two-year commitment. But we're talking to sources who say this is still something President Trump is going to want, and whoever his next chief of staff is. Now, when President Trump hired John Kelly, he wanted him to come in and instill this sense of order in a West Wing that many people saw as chaotic. He also wants a similar change, but with this chief of staff, he wants someone who is going to be very focused on the politics and handling that aspect, rather than being focused on bipartisan legislation or any of the things a chief of staff would typically focus on, and that's what he's looking for. But John, as we've reported, this search is very much still underway, because President Trump did not have a backup plan for Nick Ayers, and now several names are being floated, and it's still an open question of who exactly could be the next chief of staff.
It's only the chief of staff of the president of the United States. What's the big deal? Caitlin Collins, appreciate the new reporting live at the White House. With me in studio to share their reporting and their insights, Julie Hirschfeld Davis of the New York Times, CNN's Manu Raju, Eliana Johnson with Politico, and Bloomberg's Margaret Talev. Interesting reporting, and makes perfect sense. You're heading into the reelection campaign. You want to have a fine-tuned White House, but the chief of staff is just one piece of this. This has been a consistent complaint about this White House, that they are not properly staffed at every level, not just the top people, but the deputies and the like. So where does the president go now? He has a plan to pick somebody. That somebody says no. We've seen the Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin, pretty clear signals in CNN reporting, he's not that interested. Mick Mulvaney, the budget director, pretty clear signals. Now, some of this could be fake, but that he's not interested. Bob Lighthizer, one of the president's trade aides, has come up, sent signals he's not interested. David Bossi, who worked in the campaign, his name has come up. That would be a shock to the Washington establishment. They might run for the border if that happens. Mark Meadows, the Freedom Caucus chair, Republican congressman, says absolutely not when asked about this today, but his name has come up. Yeah. Where's the president going to go?
You know, I think there's a certain amount of people saying, no, no, I don't want the job, in order that they don't stick their heads up too high, because people know that's a bad thing to do, to get too much media coverage if in the Trump administration. Ultimately, I think if pressed, several of these people would do the job out of a sense of duty or service, or simply wanting a higher profile and wanting the job. The question, the bigger question, I think, is, will this president empower his next chief of staff to actually run the White House House, give them the power to hire and fire people, make them the ultimate authority. And I think we already know the answer to that, which I think perhaps explains some of the reluctance we're hearing from the potential candidates.
But you will be mocked on Twitter, number one, and you're probably going to spend $3 to $5 million of your own money on legal fees because the Mueller investigation is going on. The Democrats are going to start with subpoena power and the like. The timing here is would make anybody, even a highly qualified candidate, even someone who loves this president, would give you pause.
Right, and I mean, I don't question the reporting around the fact that, you know, Nick Ayers wanted to stay a shorter period of time than Donald Trump wanted him to stay. I'm sure that was a factor here, but there were also other factors here, including would he be empowered to fire the people he wanted to fire and hire the people he wanted to hire. And that's always in question when you're dealing with this president. Would he have the sort of negotiating room, the running room, to kind of make some of these political decisions that the president seems to be saying he wants the chief of staff to make now, but that certainly have not been a big part of the way this White House has worked. It's fascinating to me now to hear that, you know, the president is thinking about having a chief of staff who focuses more on politics. It's not as if this current chief of staff has focused so heavily on policy and legislation. I mean, this has been a role in the Trump White House very different from the way it's been in other White Houses, where it's really the chief of staff has been the person who's at least tried to impose some sort of process on a White House that really doesn't work that way. And so there's not a lot of bandwidth to do other things, whether it be policy or politics or anything else.
But it's a different kind of politics, of course. And I think the kind of the case for Ayers, particularly in that transitional role, was a recognition that at the end, that after those midterm elections and the Democratic takeover of the House signified a completely different dynamic for the second half of this administration than the first half. And so in the case to be made in that case is you want a chief of staff who understands basically the dogs are coming, right? And that understands how to play defense, how to try to play an offensive game, a recognition that legislation is, you're pretty much done with legislation, that it's all nominations and messaging, how to bolster the White House counsel's office, how to turn Democrats against one another, that the strategic goals of the next 2 years are really different than the first 2 years, even if politics is the umbrella that they all share.
But the rest of the Republican Party, I'll say the non-Trump wing of the Republican Party, is in a panic now, in the sense that some of them didn't think Nick Ayers was maybe experienced enough for the job, but they know him. Mm-hmm. They know him. They figure he would surround himself with smart people. He reaches out to his mentors quite a bit, including mentors who told him, "You sure you want to take this job at this time?" But we'll leave that for later in the conversation. But they hear Mick Mulvaney, they say, "Okay." They hear Steve Mnuchin, they say, "Chief of staff, but we could deal with that." But they hear David Bossie or Mark Meadows, and whether you're the Republican leadership on Capitol Hill or the interest groups around town like the Chamber of Commerce, the Federation of Business, you hear those names and you panic.
Yeah, and that's absolutely right. Even though Kelly and before him, Reince Priebus, they didn't really have much, they were able to control this president. The president still did essentially what they wanted. Those two guys, the Republican leadership, believed that they could speak to them and they could reach out to them when they wanted to express their concerns privately, vent to them, and perhaps with Kelly, maybe there'd be some influence in how the White House moved forward. But ultimately, they realized that there was not a whole lot that those two men could do. I would be surprised. Mark Meadows is putting out word through his emissaries that he's absolutely not interested in going that route. I'd be surprised if someone, if he did end up taking this position, he seems this kind of the job that he has, even though he's going to be the minority, much more visible than a job being working underneath this president. But certainly, if he got that position.
You're making the point of the conversation in town in the sense that normally, if you were a Republican congressman who just learned you're going to spend at least 2 years in the minority and you get to be the White House 100%. Chief of staff, you march right down, right. Sir. You know, president says jump, you say how high. The headline of your story Sunday was perfect to this one, from pinnacle to punchline, how Trump diminished the job of his chief of staff. That's the issue. I mean, normally, I'm sorry, any Republican congressman going from the majority to the minority would be saying, "Mr. President, here I am. I know the Hill. I'll be your guy. I know politics. We'll get you into the campaign." Why?
But
you know, I think what we've seen in Reince Priebus and then John Kelly is what used to be considered the second most powerful job in Washington, something that was unquestionably a resume booster. Rahm Emanuel was White House Chief of Staff, went on to be the mayor of Chicago. Leon Panetta, White House Chief of Staff, went on to be CIA Chief, Secretary of Defense. Yes. People are starting to ask questions. If I take White House Chief of Staff in the Trump White House, is it going to help me or hurt me? And that's simply a question that would not have been asked
in
the previous White House. So you have Nick Ayers, 36-year-old ambitious Republican operative. He's a controversial figure, but nobody doubts his political skill, who said, no thanks. I think this might hurt my reputation more than it will help it. And that, I think, really says something about how the president has treated his past two chiefs of staff and that they've emerged as diminished figures, I think, which is more of a statement on the president than it is on them.
Yeah, I mean, look, Mark Meadows could maybe become chairman of a committee if he stays, if the Republicans take back the House in 2020 or beyond. So why would you subject yourself to something where who knows what you'll be doing with, in two more years?
With these two chiefs of staff, the president has sort of set them up for failure, set them up, then consider them obstacles or rivals or competitors to his own primacy, and so he's sort of shot holes in them.
It's because it's never the boss's responsibility. It's striking. Quite a system. Up next for us, an overabundance of breadcrumbs and no real clear idea where they'll ultimately lead, what Robert Mueller's latest revelations mean for the president. But as we go to break, a quick update on another case, the case of the accused Russian spy, Maria Butina. It appears Butina has reached a plea deal with federal prosecutors. She's accused, if you remember, of trying to infiltrate Republican political circles back in the 2016 campaign in order to advance Russian interests. Her attorneys have now filed a request for a change of plea hearing. We'll give you the details of that when we know more. We'll be right back. Welcome back. The president clearly feeling deeply unsettled about the latest court filings from both the special counsel's Russia investigation and from the Southern District of New York. Those new documents detailing new allegations against members of his inner circle and accusing the president himself of violating campaign finance laws. The revelations giving Democrats reason to openly, sometimes eagerly, speculate on the president's fate, suggesting his future could include impeachment, indictment, some even say prison time.
I think the more important point here is Trump knows that he's facing some pretty strong criminal liability when he leaves office, one way or another. And, you know, even if a sitting president can't be indicted, he's got to know his future looks like it's behind bars unless he cuts some sort of deal with the prosecutors.
And yet, the president continues to adamantly, often angrily, defend his innocence, usually on Twitter. The president, quoting Fox News in a new pair of tweets this morning, here are the highlights, quote, "Democrats can't find a smocking gun." We assume he means smoking gun. But the president says, no smocking gun. Yes, he says it twice. No collusion. He blames his lawyer and then finishes with a classic Trump closer, witch hunt. CNN legal analyst Shan Wu joins the conversation. There's not a legal term, smocking gun, I'm not familiar with, is there?
It's autocorrect.
Very esoteric term.
When you read the specificity, what is unusual about these documents is the specificity and the adamance, especially in which the Southern District of New York says the President of the United States as a candidate committed felony campaign finance violations. There's no alleged. They just say flatly,
that's right,
he did. Neil Katyal's point, behind bars, is that a stretch in the sense that even if the president were guilty of these campaign finance, you don't go to jail for those things? So normally, you're shaking your head. Could you?
You could. You certainly could go. I mean, there are many campaign finance violations which are more in terms of an overpayment and such. Those are usually made up with fines. But something like this, where you're actually engaging in fraud to fool the electorate, to perpetrate a fraud upon the American people, that's serious enough. You saw the John Edwards situation. They actually tried him. And I think the question really is, to my mind, not to disagree too much with Neil, who I have a lot of respect for, but how much more trouble Trump creates for himself at this point. If more is revealed by Mueller, if he gets himself into hot water with inconsistent statements and what he's already submitted written-wise, then I think they might want to pursue him after his office is over. Otherwise, if there is an impeachment, if he's removed, resigns, I don't think they're going to pursue it criminally at that point.
And it's interesting. This is Jerry Nadler. He'll be the chairman, we assume. They haven't announced all this yet, but he's in line to be the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. The Democrats will be in charge. He's trying to be careful here. He reads the campaign finance violations, and because he's one of the Democrats, and there's a divide among the Democrats, he's one of the Democrats who say, let Mueller and the Southern District of New York keep going. If they've got several months more of work, let them finish. Then we'll decide what to do with it. Other Democrats say, we get the gavel in a couple weeks. Let's go. Listen to Jerry Nadler, though, saying that even for what he has seen so far, to him, it does meet the definition of impeachment.
Well, they would be impeachable offenses. Whether they are important enough to justify an impeachment is a different question, but certainly they'd be impeachable offenses because even though they were committed before the president became president, they were committed in the service of fraudulently obtaining the office. That would be an impeachable offense.
this is why this is so important to the Democrats, in the sense that you have a specific, clear allegation laid out by a U.S. attorney's office, that U.S. attorney appointed by Donald Trump, saying the president committed felonies. So now, what's the pushback when the Democrats say we're going to have at least have oversight hearings? Maybe we'll delay the impeachment conversation, but we're going to have more, we're going to have our own investigations.
Right, and actually that is something that Mr. Nadler also said over the weekend, is that he is going to now direct his investigators to go and look into these charges themselves, and even short of an impeachment proceeding. And you know, I think it's important that he made the distinction, right, between the legal question or the congressional question of whether these are impeachable offenses, and the political question of whether we then want to, whether his committee and the Democrats want to then pursue impeachment. Right. I think there's going to come a point, and it may come sooner rather than later because of these charges, that, you know, those two distinctions are going to be harder to make, because if you have all Democrats, both Democrats who want to go swiftly toward an impeachment process and Democrats who want to hang back in the way that Nadler has counseled hanging back, both agreeing that there are impeachable offenses, how do you then make the case to Democrats, to their base, that, well, but instead we're not going to do that?
And ironically, I think if this were year seven of the Trump administration, heading into year seven rather than heading into year three, it'd probably be an easier case for the Democrats to unify around, right? But you have impeachment is a political remedy for something that could be happening in the court system to an individual who was not an office holder, right? So, but elections are also political remedies, and the president can run for re-election and is running for re-election. And so if you're a Democrat, your overarching goal is to win the White House next time, right? So how do you balance those two goals? If impeachment would not actually succeed ultimately in the end because of control of the Senate, then what are you doing, right? Are you hurting your own case or helping your own case? So I think, you know, that's always what the consideration has been. It is still what the consideration is now.
So the reasonable argument for Democrats is, look, these guys are putting court filings in, you know, a couple times a week. Let them go. Just keep them going. If these are Republican-led investigations, so I'm sorry, Mr. President, your Deputy Attorney General named Bob Mueller, and the Southern District of New York is a Republican-appointed attorney. Let them keep going. One of the fascinating parts over the weekend was the Republicans on this question. Near silence, unless they're booked on a Sunday show and they have to answer the question from Republicans about the question, a federal prosecutor says the President of the United States committed felony campaign finance violations. Here are the documents. Here's the evidence. Read it. This is Marco Rubio, booked on a Sunday show yesterday. Added a lot of ifs, and ifs. Let's wait. It's an accusation. It's an allegation. But even he's starting to get to this.
If someone has violated the law, the application of the law should be applied to them like it would to any other citizen in this country. And obviously, if you're in a position of great authority like the presidency, that would be the case.
If. But this is getting harder for Republicans.
I think that's right. I think the concern among Republicans who see the Trump White House kind of burrowing in on itself, I think the Washington Post used the term in a bunker mentality, is that there isn't going to be a recognition in the White House of how much trouble they're in and how to respond to this, because the president is dug in on this. And as far as the Democrats are concerned, the question for them is, because impeachment is a political act, is it potentially something that could backfire on them in the 2020 election? And while they might succeed in impeaching Trump in the House because they have control, would it backfire on them? Would they lose the election in 2020? Would it be a self-defeating act?
But for all that talk about the chief of staff, that everything we've been focusing on, the real news really isn't there. The real news really is this development last week with Mr. Mueller in the Southern District of New York. A tremendously important development.
And how it affects everything, like hiring a new chief of staff. In a few minutes, we're going to get to the new White House counsel. It affects everything they do, because the president knows the Trump organization is now under investigation. The president knows everybody in the campaign who might have possibly known about those payments is under investigation. The president knows he's under investigation, because remember, they're telling us what they have to tell us, but they're leaving out a lot of things of what the rest of they're doing. I just want to bring this into the conversation. I made fun of the president, who said smoking gun twice in a tweet today, a few moments ago. This today in spell check, you might call it. Can't save you. Smocking is a type of embroidery made of many small folds sewn into place. That's from Merriam-Webster, which has taken upon itself in recent days to troll the president on Twitter, if you will, when he either misspells things or Scott Free was the one they got him on last week. To the indictment question, we're having a little fun because the president has typos in his tweets, but it's not a funny issue in the sense that, to the indictment question, if you read some of the language, is that the statute of limitations would run out in 2022. So can they file a sealed indictment that carries over? Or if the president won re-election, would those things disappear because he'd be the sitting president in 2022 and the statute of limitations passes?
I don't think they would follow a sealed indictment because it kind of runs into the same problem of whether you indict or not. There's an argument, statute of limitations are fuzzy things. There's an argument that would be like a continuing violation that maybe would get
conspiracy
you out.
Conspiracy would get you out of
that,
it.
Right.
Yeah. So we won't see bumper stickers re-elect Trump, run out the clock?
I don't think so.
I appreciate you coming in. Up next for us here, hold on to your wallet. Trouble overseas causing some very serious turmoil on Wall Street today. Welcome back. The Dow falling sharply to start the week. This as investors factor in new fears about Brexit. The British Prime Minister, Theresa May, saying a short time ago she's now postponing a vote in Parliament on her deal for the government of England struck with the EU. Amid heckling, she acknowledged, quote, widespread concern about parts of the agreement and said she'll press the EU for more changes, but she'll also start planning for the possibility that no agreement will be reached. Our business and politics correspondent, Christina Alessi, joins us from the market. Christina, Brexit, trade wars, a lot for the market to ponder, and it's not good today.
That's right. A few things are spooking investors. As you mentioned, trade is one of them. Today, a Chinese court essentially banned Apple from importing and selling iPhones into China. That is seen largely as retaliation against the United States. And this ongoing trade war between the U.S. and China is still unresolved. Investors don't like that. That was certainly bad news. More bad news this morning, as you mentioned, Brexit and whether or not the UK will be able to divorce from the EU in an orderly fashion. Now, why do investors here in the US care about an orderly exit? Because they don't want to see any kind of disruption in economic growth anywhere in the world. And if you have a disorderly exit from the EU, the UK divorcing the EU, essentially, that may cause an economic downturn there, and it may have ripple effects all around the world at a time when people are starting to use the R word, recession. You hear it from investors, from economists, starting to look at the market and say, okay, does this mean anything? Do these volatile days, does this downturn in the market actually mean that we have a fundamental problem in economic growth and potentially a fundamental problem in domestic growth? And that is the real big question mark here that investors are pondering at the end of the year. Typically, we don't see these kinds of high volatility days in December, but investors looking ahead, trying to figure it out, John.
Christina Alessi on the floor for us. Rocky day after a rocky week. Hang in there. We'll keep in touch. Up next for us here, the White House braces for a flood of Democratic investigations. So where does the new White House counsel start? Welcome back. Another face in a very important White House job. Today is the first day on the job for the new White House counsel, Pat Cipollone. It's been nearly 2 months since his predecessor, Don McGahn, resigned. And it's just weeks before Democrats take control of the House with a long list of oversight investigations. While Cipollone's primary responsibility is to protect the office of the presidency, not the president himself, Cipollone once advised the Trump team on the Mueller probe. That's one reason delayed taking the job. Also served as a Justice Department official during the George H.W. Bush administration. Emmett Flood has served on an interim basis. He'll now return to his role as special counsel to the president, dealing largely with the Mueller investigation. Now, Americans don't tend to know the name of the White House counsel. If you're living in Omaha or California or Texas, it's like, so what? Who cares? However, it's an incredibly important job at an incredibly pressure-packed time at the White House. How will this be different? Is the president who got soured on Don McGahn, thought Don McGahn was a problem, is this one going to work?
Well, Americans who follow politics are probably going to know the name of Donald Trump's White House counsel. Don McGahn was an incredibly important player in the first 2 years, and I think Pat Cipollone is going to be an incredibly important player in the second 2 years. And his team as well are going to be amongst the most important behind-the-scenes players, in particular because Democrats have assumed control of Congress. And it's Cipollone's office, though they aren't involved in responding to the Russia investigation, they will lead the charge in defending the president from Democrats' investigations on Capitol Hill. That will be important because it's going to be important to the president. Cipollone has already taken the interesting move of hiring a deputy whose sole charge is going to be leading the responses to those investigations. And for that reason, I think you'll see an increased prominence of that office and an increased increased prominence for Cipollone and the rest of his team.
Every time one of these subpoenas is issued from either the Oversight Committee or the Judiciary Committee, any of the committees that the Democrats control on the House side, when they are trying to get an information involving the president, involving something he personally did or as president, or something that the administration did, family separation, you know, we forget about, we had this whole question about security clearances and did they play fast and loose with the security clearance process. There's obviously this question about the president's tax returns and should they have access to those. Every single time they issue one of these subpoenas, there is going to be a lawyer, really a team of lawyers at the White House that has to figure out how to respond to that. What are they going to give? What are they going to withhold? Whether to exercise privilege in certain cases or not. And they're going to have to be coordinating with all of the agencies on these responses as well. And some of the things that come out through those investigations, and we're not even talking about impeachment here, we're just talking about investigating what the president has done as president. And potentially what his tax returns may show, all of that will have to go through Cipollone's office and his team.
Plus environmental regulations, business regulations. It's you mentioned immigration. You're going to have this about the coal industry. You're going to have this about the clean air, clean water, about judicial nominations. So before you jump in, this is Jerry Nadler again. He's going to be the chairman of one of the key committees, just one. There'll be dozens of committees sending the White House. First, it's a letter. Please send us this. When the White House says no, then it's a threatening letter. Then maybe it's a subpoena. This is the world we're about to get into.
We have to look at the Russian interference with the campaign and what did the president know about that and to what extent did he cooperate with that, if he did. We have to look at his business dealings and his lying about that. We have to look at the fact that he surrounded himself with crooks, and we have to get to the bottom of this, find out what all the facts are, we and the special counsel, and then make decisions.
Welcome to work, Mr. Cipollone.
Yeah, and look, Nadler has already sent a letter to the White House saying we have all these requests from information from the last 2 years. They wanted a response essentially immediately to those requests. I've talking to Republicans on the Hill. They're advising the White House to not comply with all these requests, to fight a lot of these requests. And believing that what's the worst that will happen, maybe some people will be held in contempt, but really what's the worst case scenario from that? Now, also, protecting the White House staff is going to be crucial. Jared Kushner is going to be a focus, potentially, for some committees. The House Foreign Affairs Committee, I'm told, is interested in looking at Saudi Arabia as a whole, including potentially Jared Kushner's ties to the Crown Prince, which we know from New York Times investigation over the weekend showed that he suggested they weather this storm in the aftermath of the Jamal Khashoggi murder. So those kind of things will come via the White House Counsel's Office. How do they respond to that kind of inquiry as well?
And then there's the president himself, who has these whims, often seen on Twitter. I won't run the sound, but Marco Rubio saying this Sunday, like, please don't, on the issue of, you look at the new Manafort filings. Paul Manafort, the special counsel, alleges, kept in contact with the White House. A lot of people think that was part of an effort to say, here, I'm going to tell you everything I know about the special counsel investigation, and maybe you're going to pardon me.
Yeah, well, yes. And there are two lenses through which I would view, like, the job that the White House counsel now is charged with doing. And one is protecting or maximizing executive power and executive privilege, those kind of worlds. And the other is that balancing the job, which is to represent the White House, with the kind of political pressure or imperative to represent the president. Again, like, in an ideal world, they would have the same interest. But in this case, they may not always have the interest. The president continues to have his own legal team, obviously needs his own legal team. So what is the White House counsel's role going to be? And I think with Rex Tillerson, whatever you want to say about Rex Tillerson, and it's a different job than that of White House counsel, but the glimpse of what we saw in his conversation with Bob Schieffer over the last few days, this idea that the president would often ask him for things where Tillerson would say, well, you can't do that under the law. That's also, you know, part of the White House counsel's job to say, this is your goal. These are the limitations on how you achieve that goal.
We have a constitution or a treaty or a law and go at it. He's got to hire a lot of lawyers. We'll see how that one plays out. A lot of jobs open if you're a young lawyer interested in some work in town. Up next is the season for government shutdown and a fight over the wall. Can the president cut a deal with Chuck and Nancy? Congress is back to work today with a short calendar, but a long list of things to get done before a holiday season shutdown deadline. The must-do list includes funding a quarter of the government. reaching agreement on a new farm bill, overhauling the National Flood Insurance Program, providing additional disaster relief, and extending a landmark law against domestic violence. The biggest obstacle in negotiations, quite familiar, the president's demand for $5 billion in border wall funding. Democratic leaders Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi set to meet with the president tomorrow at the White House to talk things over. Republican Senator Lindsey Graham offers this advice for the president.
If I were the president, I would dig in and not give in on additional wall funding. I'd want the whole $5 billion because the caravan is a game changer. So I'd say, I want 2 years of wall funding, and I'll give legal status to the DACA recipients.
Yeah.
That's a good deal for the country. And let's just see what happens. But the president is in a good spot here. Mm. He needs to dig in and not give in when it comes to wall funding and put DACA on the table and see what Nancy Pelosi says then.
Is the president in a good position here? Is that deal even possible in this environment?
Well, Nancy Pelosi has said it's not, and Donald Trump himself has suggested that it's not in interviews in the last couple of days, or in the last couple of weeks, I should say. I mean, I think what Lindsey Graham, part of what Lindsey Graham is trying to do here is what a lot of people around President Trump like to do when he's about to get in a room with Chuck and Nancy, which is to kind of caution him against cutting a deal that they think would be a bad deal, and that frankly he would later turn around and say, I don't want to do that deal. I feel like I got played, and then lead to a bigger sort of crack up because we are racing against a clock here. But he has given no indication that he's willing to drop his demand for $5 billion in wall funding. And Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi have given no indication that they're willing to come up to that number, even if it's not for the wall, even if it's just for border security. So it's not clear what deal there is to be made there. There's clearly a compromise to be had, but neither side has really showed any willingness to get to the middle there. And so I think the question is going to be what happens in that room tomorrow and what the president is able to sell to himself and the people around him as a win in exchange for coming off of that position, because I just don't think there's a way that Democrats accept $5 billion in wall funding.
But there's also some mistrust among and between the Democrats, if you will. I want to read you this quote from Politico, Congresswoman Philemon Vea of Texas, who doesn't trust Chuck Schumer, apparently. Listen to this. This is a New York City conspiracy. This is a New York City conspiracy. And Schumer is on the verge of giving Trump his third down payment on the wall. Pelosi's position is that the meeting is meaningless unless she and those of us who oppose the wall funding can ensure that we bring all the other Democrats along for the ride. You might as well call this the Schumer-Trump wall, in my view. Was the congressman...
It's really interesting that it's coming from Phil Vella, who's actually one of the Nancy Pelosi's sharpest critics. He's a certain no vote on the floor, but he believes her position. He trusts her in her hardline position against more funding for the wall, which Schumer has gotten a lot of flack from the left, is saying that he's open to more border security money, $1.6 billion that was negotiated between Democrats and Republicans on the Senate side. Some Democrats in the House, I believe, that is too much money. Now, Schumer's office says this is not wall money. This is border security money. It's for fencing and for other things. The White House believes that's a down payment to the wall funding. Some House Democrats believe this is a down payment to the wall funding. So it shows the tricky politics for Senate Democrats to go any higher than the $1.6 billion, let alone the $5 billion that the president wants. And how they navigate that is still uncertain at this late date.
And in the middle of all that, you're trying to do the farm bill, which is incredibly important, especially to farm state lawmakers. You're trying to do flood insurance. You're trying to do more disaster relief, the stuff that people get flack for when they go home, matters in their states and in their districts. Is there any possibility? The other things people say, oh, here's our last chance this year. Republicans still have the House, still have the Senate. Criminal justice reform, a Bob Mueller protection bill, a Yemen resolution that criticizes the administration of Saudi Arabia, Congress finally adopting stronger rules about how it handles sexual harassment issues within the Congress. All of these things, some of which there's bipartisan, at least general consensus on, what, going to fall away?
I think many of them are likely to fall away, particularly because we're running up here against Christmas, which means a lot of these lawmakers want to get out of town. And I think they'll be happy to set aside some of these bipartisan initiatives. The bipartisan spirit may leave them. And they're looking to get.
They're going to need a lot of cooperation to get things through, especially in the Senate. What Yemen resolution is one to watch out for. That could be on the floor as soon as Wednesday because of the unusual process that they're using to bring that up. And that would be a rebuke to the president if that passes, because it would pull back U.S. involvement in the Saudi-led war in Yemen, which, of course, the administration furiously opposes. But other than that, a lot of these other things are going to fall.
I think there's space for that one. And I think with on the immigration front, the wall versus DACA, one of the real challenges that divides the Democrats is whether they trust President Trump to actually do right by the DACA piece of it. There's no amount of border security or whatever you want to call it, right, that you'll commit to if you don't believe that the end goal of protecting the group that you're trying to protect is actually within
reach.
And
they think they might have more leverage once they have the majority. We'll see how that one plays out. I would not be an optimist for much getting done, but hopefully I'll be wrong about that one. Up next, John Hickenlooper says negative campaign ads make him, you see him right there, want to take a shower. But, can you run a positive campaign in 2020? Is that your future president? Today's Democrats 2020 update, John Hickenlooper edition. No announcement yet from Colorado's Democratic governor, but he's already hired a pollster, a fundraiser, and launched a PAC to start organizing and raising cash. And yes, his party is pushing to elect more women and minorities. We saw that in 2018. It's a goal for the future, but Hickenlooper says his timing could not be better.
As a white guy, are you trying to calculate whether or not this is the right time for you?
Well, this is the time it's worked out, right? I finished my term as governor. I finished in 1 month. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a problem solver. I've been good at bringing people together that historically have been antagonistic. Maybe the country needs someone that can bring the divided parts of the country and the divided constituencies back together.
Yes, no, maybe so.
I mean, why not, right? I mean, everybody is running. Everybody almost seems like everybody in the Democratic Party thinks they can be president. So why not a run from a purple state, former governor of important state in 2020? Sure, why not? I mean, this is going to be a huge field. It's wide open. I was talking to someone who's considering it himself last week, who told me that, you know, it's... there is an opportunity for anybody to run at this point.
But
that's why he'll do it.
An outsider. A lot of Democrats think get outside of Washington. Get outside of Washington. Two-term governor was the Denver mayor. Oversaw marijuana legalization in the state of Colorado. Has passed some gun control legislation. Other jobs, geologist, and most importantly, he brews beer.
Yeah, I mean, if there's one thing that is actually really important, let's not gloss over that point. But if there's one truth that we all learned in the 2016 race, it's that when you have a 17-way primary, it's a different dynamic than if it's two or three candidates. So anyone can emerge. Really, you can defy all the rules. The question is, can the person who emerges then go on, if they were to secure the nomination, to actually win the election? Can they bring people together and tap them? So I think right now there's, you know, he would be crazy to take himself out of it. Why would he do that? Like he said, this is his time. But it is certainly a sign of the times that in 2007, 2008, the question people were asking is, can an African-American man win as the president? Now the question is, can a white guy
win a Democratic nomination because of all this energy in the party?
Yeah.
But I mean, again, and sometimes we make this mistake sitting in Washington. We think, you know, senator this or senator that or somebody who's come through here might be a good time to be an outside guy from the West, the states that are changing, the new map emerging, to say, hey, you know, don't forget about us.
Absolutely. And I mean, there certainly is no disincentive for him to get in for all the reasons that Manu and Margaret were just saying. But the other thing that's fascinating is, you know, obviously his pitch is going to be, you can tell from what he's saying and from his political profile that he's kind of sketched out over the last several years, is that he's someone who can bring people together, that he's someone who can work in a bipartisan way, do some of those middle of the road things. Is that?